Welcome back. You're watching KTN Sunrise Live. I do hope you've been able to get yourself a glass of water from that very heated argument. Have a glass of juice. We definitely are doing that in studio. But we want to shift gears in our discussion this morning, talking about youth and the role that they play in the development. And the UN is certainly taking notice of this issue, and UN Habitat in particular, taking a look at issues of youth in development and the role that they can play in that particular process. And joining me this morning from UN Habitat, that advisory council, we have Raphael Obonyo, who's representing us here in Kenya. And thank you very much, John Anugraha. I hope I got that right.
Yes.
Representing Asia in the UN Habitat. And we're going to talk about the issues that are affecting youth, not just in Kenya, in Asia, around the world. Are some of those issues cross-cutting? And what role exactly can the youth play in terms of development in their country and being more participatory in some of the issues that surround them and how they can sort them out? So thank you, gentlemen, for joining us this morning. Raphael, let's talk about the first thing, obviously, that happened that I think brought this to light was the president's address at UN Habitat. Tell us more about that.
Thank you so much, and thanks for inviting us to this show. We feel greatly honored to be here as representative from the UN Habitat Youth Advisory Board, and also young people who are involved in various projects and courses to support young people. As UN Habitat, we have a governing council, and that is held every 2 years, and it brings together different stakeholders to basically deliberate on agendas of UN Habitat, which include issues of urbanization, issues of development, issues of human settlement. And this year they were making special reference to youth and women in terms of how they can participate and contribute towards development, especially within urban centers, because it is projected that by 2050, almost 50% of people will be living in urban centers, and so that is a critical concern. And then there's been conversation and discussion around that. And since this the governing council was being held in Kenya, President Uhuru Kenyatta was invited to come and inaugurate the function. And part of his speech, I think he was first of all committing to continue working closely with the United Nations. I mean, both United Nations as a whole, but also more specifically with the UN Habitat, to address specific concerns and specific agendas of UN Habitat, which I already outlined. But interestingly, in his speech, he also, of course, talked a lot about the issue of youth in terms of how his government, his newly elected government, hopes to engage with dealing with issues of youth, which include unemployment, issues of how to provide, access to education, access to health, issues of resources and issues of capacity, how his government hopes to deal with such issues.
Okay, and talking about the advisory council that you sit on, tell us about the need for that. And this is obviously internationally based, it's not just in Kenya, but in other areas around the world. Tell us about the role that you play in that council and how important that is for you.
Thank you very much for inviting me. My name, as you said, John Anugra. I'm from India. And what happened is at the World Urban Forum, it's the body that comes together with the government officials, and people are invited. It's a forum of the UN Habitat in cooperation with the local governments, and it's done in different cities. Mm-hmm. So on the fourth Urban Forum in Nanjing in China, there was the Youth Advisory Board that was installed, and at the Governing Council, the 22nd Governing Council in Nairobi in 2009, it was launched. So Youth Advisory Board is potentially six regions and a male and a female candidate from each of these regions. So I'm representing Asia Pacific, and my colleague is from Australia. So likewise, the six regions. And then there are two independent appointed advisory board members as well, who are representing informal settlements. So we are 14 together, and the idea of the Youth Advisory Board first is to voice the opinion of young people from their own regions, and also to see that youth is mainstreamed in most of the work in UN Habitat agenda, and also in UN in general. Our efforts during this governing council, for example, is to make sure that we lobby with our ministers. We tell them that youth is important in the agenda of the government and the United Nations, and we ensure that resolutions are passed and are effective that young people are empowered and young people are not just treated as target groups, but they are participatory included in governance and the structure of committees and things like that. Mm-hmm. So that's the general idea of the advisory board. It advises the UN Habitat Secretariat, but at the same time it works and takes action in the region because it's a regional body as well, and we try to work with our own peers in coming from our own regions.
Okay, and it's important that you have that youth advisory at that level, such that you're able to speak about the issues that are facing young men and women, particularly from your region. And perhaps we sit in Kenya and we think, oh, these are the only issues that are affecting us and nobody else is suffering like we are. From your perspective in India, what are some of the greatest challenges that youth and young people there are facing today?
All right, as you know, India is the second most populous country in the world. And with that population increasing, I think we are also in this transition phase of moving from agrarian economy to industrial economy. Mm-hmm. And a lot of youth are there who need jobs. So I would say that employment is one of the biggest issue. And with urbanization, a lot of people from the rural areas are moving into the urban areas to seek jobs. But if we don't have enough opportunities for young people to work, then it will be very difficult for them to get jobs. The other aspect of it is obviously the idea of education. Mm-hmm. So when a lot of rural farmers are selling their lands and coming into the villages in the dream of mm-hmm. getting jobs and you know earning money and standing on the feet, I think the idea is whether they have that educational qualification, whether they have that skills qualification in terms of getting jobs in the urban area. So these are some of the important challenges that we are facing, and I think the Right to Education Act in India is very timely right now. Where it's been functional, and we are seeing that the education is free and mandatory for all children up to the age of 14, and they are more and more encouraged, and also you know people from other backward class and caste, scheduled caste, are ensured that they have the opportunity to be educated as well.
Okay. All right, education, jobs, and that's a lot. Rafael, does this ring true for us in Kenya?
I mean, it's the same thing, same situation here in Kenya. If you look at the levels of unemployment in Kenya, at the moment we have an unemployment rate of 40%, which is quite high. But that is not just it. The fact that 7 out of every 10 unemployed people, jobless people, are basically young people is something that should concern anyone who is concerned about issues of security and issues of stability in the country. Because they say, I mean, the condition and situation of young people in any country basically can give you a good projection of, can give you an indicator of the stability of that country. If young people are unemployed, then you surely will have high rates of crime, you surely will have high levels of insecurity, I mean, you'll surely have high levels of drug abuse and alcoholism, and that's the kind of situation we see in every part of this country. Look at issues of education. Right. A majority of young people are not able to access quality education. Mm-hmm. And where even now that we have universal primary education, where mm-hmm. everyone can access mm-hmm. Primary education, but look at it in terms of the Vision 2030. Vision 2030 basically aspires and anticipates that we are going to build a middle income economy. You can't build a middle income economy when you have a population that is basically restricted and limited to elementary level of education. So if young people cannot be assisted to access quality education beyond the primary level, then we'll have a vision that will never be achieved, and we'll keep shifting our vision mm-hmm. when it gets to 2030, the way we've done with many other visions. Mm-hmm. We'll shift it to 2060, and we'll keep shifting it because we are not basically providing the enablers that are required for us to achieve the vision. Look at issues of provision of resources. And it's an interesting thing because watching parliamentarians talking about increasing their salaries, look at the budget allocation for issues of youth and enterprise fund. Young people were being organized and were being given like 50,000. A group of 50 young people are given 50,000. Mm-hmm. So what can you do really with 50,000 uh-huh. as young people? So the levels of disparity, even in terms of provision of, mm-hmm. of resources, mm-hmm. is a great, great concern. And, mm-hmm. and I think situations in Africa are not so different from what my colleague John has also enumerated in terms of what they face in India.
And so we find that the issues that are facing young people, men and women around the world, are similar and cross-cutting issues, albeit in different ways and of course unique to the different regions and whatever's happening in their cultural surroundings and of course economically as well. But the basic need for young men and women around the world is to get a better education and get a well-paying job, or, you know, be at least able to sustain themselves. Is that right?
Yes. I mean, you know, especially coming from my country, I would say 10 years back there was this thing that when a child goes into education, the mentality is whether he would become a doctor or an engineer.
Yeah.
So this is the concept that is universally known about Indians, and of course we do have great scientists and doctors and engineers. But now the trend is changing, you know. There is encouragement for managerial aspects, there is encouragement for social entrepreneurship and things like that. And I think the concerns are universal, I would say, but there are problems with political will, there are problems with social will, there are problems with, you know, whether the youth policy is really intact or not, and whether that could impact any difference. So that is the biggest challenge that we are facing right now.
And indeed, being at the UN Habitat now, having these youth representatives around the world, male and female, representing the different regions, what then is the impact of the council and the impact of your presence on that council? Because we do know the UN Habitat is great, but it is the governments that need to put in place these policies that enable a lot of what we're saying to come to life. So what is the role then that the UN Habitat and you know, the advisory council and your role in that, playing with governments or rather even with young people in terms of putting these things into reality?
So let me say, and then Rafael can join as well. Let me say that, you know, the UN Habitat is the only UN agency that looks at youth between the age bracket of 18 to 32. Universally, United Nations looks at youth from 15 to 24. So what UN Habitat has done, maybe for one reason, that they're based, their main headquarters is based in Nairobi, and respecting the African Union Charter, they have considered the age to be 32 as the limit for young people on the advisory board. And what it has done is this gives a spectrum of, you know, college students to young professionals being part of an advisory committee, and thus impacting the youth mainstreaming that is very much required at the UN level. What we as advisory board, which is just the second term right now, so it's very at an initial phase, and our goal and agenda is very simple: to make sure that youth are given opportunities and not just seen as target groups. And I think UN Habitat does this very well, and they have a special unit for youth. And if you know, there has been a process called the U21, an initiative that is demanding the United Nations to think of a possibility of having a permanent forum on youth. And this is the biggest deal that ever one could consider, especially thinking that 60% of the world population today is young. And the General Secretary of the United Nations, Ban Ki-moon, has already appointed a special envoy of youth. And this is a big achievement. And I think UN Habitat is doing an incredible job of pushing this agenda, although it's one of the smaller agencies in, compared to the United Nations. And I think their importance of giving for young people and looking at the urban issues make it very vital, because a lot of youth are now being concentrated in urban areas.
Okay, all right. Rafa?
Yeah, I mean, just to add, like you say, you rightly said, of course, the UN, there are normally two parts, the member states and then the secretariat. And most of the resolutions that have been passed and adopted by the various member states are supposed to be domesticated and implemented locally. But you find that that is not happening. If you look at, for example, resolution on how to, on ensuring that member states, including Kenya, put in place comprehensive and effective youth policies, youth plans and youth programs. I mean, they remain discussions at the international level, but they're never brought down at the level where countries are basically pushed to ensure that they put in place this kind of instruments and infrastructure that can help in terms of realizing and actualizing these resolutions. And so, as young people, we are saying it is our role and responsibility not just to watch our member states, our countries, pass I mean, sign resolutions and commit to implement certain instruments, and then when go back and just continue with business as usual. So we want to hold them to account and to say, look, you've passed this resolution, you have to implement it. For example, you've committed yourself to put in place an effective youth policy and youth plans. You have to do that. And then the whole idea of ensuring that it cannot be for us without us. Young people have to be part of it. Mm-hmm. And then another issue is also ensuring that we're not just part of the statistics, mm-hmm. that, oh, youth, there's a youth mm-hmm. bar, there's a growing population of young people, and and so young people are participating. We want meaningful participation. Uh-huh. We want to be the ones leading. I mean, we want youth-led processes to basically ensure that we respond effectively to the concerns, to the needs, and to the problems facing young people. Mm-hmm. So we don't just want to hear, you know, these paternalistic approaches that we are going to provide. For example, I mean, if you look at most governments and politicians for that matter, they say, oh, we are going to provide employment for young uh-huh. people. But how are you going to do that if young people themselves are not involved in the processes of, I mean, basically, providing, making their contribution in terms of suggesting or even guiding what they think they can do? I mean, that's why most programs are failing, because they're generated at a level where uh-huh. young people are not involved. And so by the time you get to involve young people, those projects collapse.
Okay. It's just what John had mentioned about youth not being a target group, but being a part of the process and providing youth with opportunities. Now, there's the member states that sign up to a lot of these resolutions that are made and that make promises. What can we do to hold the member states to account if they say these are some of the programs that we're going to put in place for young people, and we will involve young people in those processes? What are some of the things, John, you know, that perhaps you would be telling the UN Habitat when you sit in your meetings, in terms of just keeping the member states accountable to some of the promises that they make?
Let me also give you a background where, you know, Youth Advisory Board is doing that, but what UN Habitat is doing, they're not just talking about this. Mm-hmm. So I want to mention about one of the member states, that's Norway. Mm-hmm. The government of Norway has initiated something called the Urban UN Habitat Youth Fund. And for the Kenyans who are watching today, the deadline to apply for this fund, if you're looking for funds to do a project that is youth-led for okay. the youth and by the youth, uh-huh. You can get amount up to $25,000, and they have... the deadlines have been extended, so 20th April is the deadline. You still have time if you want to apply. Mm. So government of Norway has put in together something called the Youth Fund, mm-hmm. and as led by an example, they have shown the leadership that youth are important. There's opportunities for youth all over the world to apply for these funds, do some projects. And likewise, the government of Kenya, the government of Nigeria, the government of Brazil, the mm-hmm. government of Sri Lanka are pushing this agenda and showing that this youth agenda is important, and they are supporting that in the resolution, the governing councils. In fact, in the governing council that is going on right now, this is historical that two youth resolutions are being discussed, and hopefully by 19th of April, we hope it will be passed, and that will be one of the successful UN Habitat governing council in terms of young people for mm-hmm. us. So I hope what we try to do during the governing council is also, we have these youth caucus meetings, and every morning we come, we strategize, and we say, let's approach our own governments to begin with, okay. and say that, you know, this government is doing it. This uh-huh. government is doing it. Why not you? Mm-hmm. And I think yesterday, me and some of our colleagues were at the High Commission of Nigeria. Mm-hmm. The government of Nigeria has donated about $3 million for the African Urban Youth Forum, or the urban program. Mm-hmm. And I think this is a milestone, because we would look at a developed country mm-hmm. to give donations and contributions. And here is a country which is leading by example. So these are some of the things that are happening by the member states. And I would definitely encourage the Kenyans who are here to pressure that, because the president here is new mm-hmm. and you know, he needs the support of youth. And I think asking him for the rights of youth is the apt time right now.
Mm-hmm. It is indeed. And just to get off of that, Rafael.
Yes.
Are you optimistic about our new administration?
Yeah, the Kenyan government. Mm-hmm. of course, I'm very optimistic for various reasons. One is that the current government was basically campaigning on the basis that they are a youthful generation, mm-hmm. a digital generation, and that they're going to take into consideration mm-hmm. the issues and concerns of young people. Mm-hmm. And of course, looking at the Jubilee's manifesto, they've outlined and they've elaborated on how, I mean, on some of the things they hope mm-hmm. to do for young people. And to that extent, we are hoping that they're going to accomplish that. But this is also not the first time that we've had a government talking about young people, mm-hmm. because it has almost become fashionable that everyone who wants to be elected, I mean, brands himself as a young person and tries to associate himself with the young mm-hmm. with young people. And so part of what we are doing as young people is to organize ourselves to hold the government to account mm-hmm. based on the constitution, because our constitution now provides a lot of opportunities for young people, but also based on the promises of the current government that they're going to take into consideration. Actually, they're going to have youth as a priority in most of their programs. And okay. so we are also following closely, and we are not just sitting back and watching. I mean, we'll continue. And you've seen just last week we had a youth lobby group coming out to say that, look, you promised us jobs, we want these jobs today. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. They promised young people free loans. We are waiting mm-hmm, for those free mm-hmm, loans. Mm-hmm. I mean, all these promises, we don't want it to be fashionable to talk mm-hmm. about young people. We want, whenever you talk about young people and you give them a promise, you have to fulfill that.
Okay, that's actually 10 million jobs, I think, they promised by the year 2017. So all eyes will be on them to see if they can do that. But that's, you know, away from the government. And like you say, there's been some great initiatives by some of the member states in terms of committing not just, you know, promises, but putting their money where their mouth really is. Let's take a look at it from the young person's point of view. What do you think it is as young people that holds many of us back? Let's start with you, Rafael, in Kenya, and we'll take a look at India and, of course, look at it from an international scope.
I think, situations in life can make you hopeless, or they can motivate you to want to get to certain levels. For example, poverty. I mean, I, for one, was born and brought up in Korogoshan, and situations there are quite, I mean, they're very appealing mm-hmm. situations mm-hmm. of poverty. Mm-hmm. And what poverty can do is it can make you hopeless and decide, I have no other way of mm-hmm. getting out of this, and so I'll remain in this kind of situation perpetually. But it can also motivate you and inspire you to want to say, look, this is not what I want my children to inherit. And I think there are many young people who are coming out to do that. And we've seen it in our own situation, for example. If you look at Korogosho, where I was born and brought up, mm-hmm. we came up with the idea of a community radio, the first ever in this part of, in Kenya. Mm-hmm. We were saying, look, we might not have so much, but there's something that we can do. Mm-hmm. So whatever little we have in terms of capacity, in terms of resources, in terms of ideas, we can pull it together and do something. And I think that is what young people must start realizing, that we shouldn't wait. You know, even this thing of waiting for a government is going to do this, we might stagnate there forever. We must start with whatever little that we have as young people and do something with it. If you look at innovations, I mean, there are great ideas that young people are coming up with. Look at, I mean, something like M-Pesa. Mm-hmm. I mean, all of us know that, I mean, this is an idea that came from, I mean, young people, you mm-hmm. know, a young person who sat and, mm-hmm. and thought, I can do, I mean, I can invent something, and then, of course, sought for resources and all that. So I think the idea is for us to be more proactive. Mm-hmm. I think we need a lot of personal initiative as young people. We shouldn't sit back and wait. I think we need to do that. But the other thing that I think we should do as a country is, I mean, I saw after the elections the way young people were tearing at each other mm-hmm. on social media, because we might not be tribal as such, but we have hang-ups of these negatives from older generations, mm-hmm. negative ethnicity, you know, cronyism, you know, issues of corruption. We should be able to overcome that and be truly a free generation that is borderless, that is not held captive by these things that keep, retarding us and taking us back. And okay. so if we're able to overcome some of those challenges, then I think we can go very far as young people.
All right. John?
Well, you know, one of the things I have noticed, especially in our generation and this 21st century, India and China today are playing this important role. So is South Africa, Brazil, the BRICS nation. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the young people in these countries, I would think, are as much concerned of the urban issues and the rural issues in their own country. And they've been trying to strive, voice their opinion of rights. And the generation, as far as I'm looking at it, I think a lot of young people look at rights and responsibilities that go together, and they're same side of the coin. So we, as much as we think about our rights, I think we are looking at ourselves, and we are trying to be responsible as well mm-hmm. and trying to take some actions, not just because we want our growth, personal growth, but also we want our peers to move in that direction. And this generation has the privilege, I would say, to travel a lot. The world is shrinking, mm-hmm. and the aviation industry is boomed, and everyone can travel for wherever they want. I mean, if you compare it to our previous generation, that wasn't possible. And the idea of global citizenship has come in now. Mm-hmm. And I think young Kenyans and others would relate to it, as Rafael just mentioned, the borderless society. We are actually living that, and the virtual world has done that to us. And as young people, I think we relate that, and we say that an issue that happened in Kenya, or the issue that happened in America for the marathons that happened in Boston, mm-hmm. we had bomb blasts in Bangalore yesterday. Mm-hmm. So these issues are not just issues of that country today. These are issues of young people saying that this is wrong, and we need to change that. Mm-hmm. So I think the concerns are very universal, and people are moving in the direction of global citizenship. As much as they want to work in their own countries, mm-hmm. they're also being leaders of the world as well.
Right. And you know, when you just mentioned that, it brought to mind the issue of the gang rape that took place in India, and how that was just felt around the world, and all young people who came out and said, you know, that shouldn't happen. And I think, you know, some of the issues that you mentioned are cross-cutting. You know, rape doesn't only happen in India. Yes. It happens here, it happens in the United States, it happens just about everywhere. But that was one issue, particularly for young people, that was able to bring everybody together and say, in my own capacity, in my own situation, in my own country, yeah. You know, this is something we must say no to. So, you know, interesting that you bring up the issue about everybody in the world sort of, you cannot say now you're just a resident of India or Kenya. Yeah. I think we just are definitely world citizens. So now getting into the process of now being involved at the UN Habitat level, and this is a good thing, the UN is now starting to recognize that young people have a voice. Ban Ki-moon talking about this quite seriously and saying young people really need to be heard. This is a good step, right? You know, even at the UN level, and that perhaps will trickle down to the member states as well.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think the UN, just like many institutions and organizations, they are coming to realize the importance of responding to the concerns, the needs, and issues that affect young people. And UN in particular, I think there's been some sort of reforms and transformation taking place, mm-hmm. For the last 10 years or so. For example, there are certain remarkable initiatives that have come up within the UN, looking at from 1995, they put together a blueprint to guide the engagement with young people, the World Program of Action for Youth, which mm-hmm. is basically, they didn't have that before on how to deal with young people. And so they have this kind of that blueprint that they use basically in terms of strategically engaging with young people. Ban Ki-moon, the Secretary General, mm-hmm. has put in his priority of action and agenda, he's identified young people as one of his key priorities, which again is quite remarkable, indicating that UN is greatly concerned about young people. The other day, just this year, mm-hmm. the Secretary General again appointed the first ever special envoy on youth issues. That is something that has not been there, and this is something that was passed by the General Assembly for the first time, and now we have Ahmed Al-Zenawi, who is now the special envoy on youth. And of course, there have been other initiatives like establishment of UN voluntary program that specifically target young people. So some of these things, I think, are an indication that even global institutions like the United Nations mm-hmm. are coming to realize that it is important, it is urgent, and it is imperative for them to deal with issues and concerns of young people.
Okay.
You know, one of the things I should say that when we look at the Millennium Development Goals and 2015, mm-hmm. We can evaluate, and we don't really need to look at the reports, but we can evaluate that young people have played a significant role to achieve a lot of these targets. And you know, we should acknowledge that. And I think I commend the leadership of our executive director and deputy executive director of UN Habitat, where UN Habitat is saying very clearly that youth and gender, or women, is a specific agenda, and this governing council is specially focused on this issue. Mm-hmm. So they have lobbied enough, and they have had a lot of discussion with the general secretary, I suppose, and the UN Habitat is moving in that direction. So we're not stopping there. We're not saying that this is only the resolutions. We are getting money to mm-hmm. fund activities with youth, And all these things are moving simultaneously. So it's not just action, or it's not just talking. It's a mix of both. And I think that's why we like working with the UN Habitat Youth Advisory Board, because it's just the second term that we are here, and there are a lot of chance and a lot of opportunities and a lot of growth. And I thank the leadership of the youth unit and livelihoods who's supporting this idea and who encourages to go out, reach out to the young people, and make sure that we're not just contained with UN Habitat, but we are making sort of a cross-cutting in intergovernmental panels, in governments and NGOs and others as well.
Okay. Rafael, finally, as we close our discussion this morning, the possible outcomes of this, where would you like to see young people in Kenya 5 years from now, and what role do you think the UN Habitat will be able to play in that? When you take a look back 5 years later and you say we were able to do this, and I like what John is saying, it's not just about talk, it's a mix of both talk and action, but what would be a possible outcome for you, say, 5 years from now?
I look at a situation where, like we already indicated, we share challenges and concerns, but that is not just it. I think we also share dreams and aspirations, and I think we should build on the dreams and aspirations that we share as young people within a particular context, be it a country, or be it a region, or be it the world, like it is. We've been brought together by UN Habitat representatives from different countries, and we realize that we share dreams and aspirations. How can we build on this? That, for me, is key. The other thing is, we must, as young people, we must be proactive. We must take the lead. I mean, we cannot wait. There's this idea of we are leaders of tomorrow. We cannot be leaders of tomorrow, not just for our, I mean, not just in terms of the country, but also in terms of our own personal development. Right. We must take initiative, and we must do what we have to do to ensure that we get out of certain challenges and certain problems and certain situations that continue holding us back. Three, like I already indicated, we must overcome some of these challenges that things like negative ethnicity and cronyism, favorism that are being perpetuated by what I would consider the older generation. Because my argument has been, for example, as young people in this country, we might not be tribal, but we have hang-ups of tribalism. I mean, we see what older generation is doing, and sometimes we think that's the only way to survive. When the push comes to shove, the best thing you can do is to run back to your tribe. But we are a tribe. We must be a tribeless generation. I mean, As a young person, regardless of what tribe I am, I can marry anybody. I mean, that was not possible many years ago. So we must act our age. We must act we must live in the current times. And I think for me, that is extremely key. In terms of involvement in processes, we must not imagine that someone else is going to do it on our behalf, be it an individual or the government. And so Kenya, for example, I have not seen anywhere in the world where the government has rescued young people. It is always young people coming out to do it for themselves. And so even with a government like the Jubilee government that commits to work with young people, to provide whatever goodies and niceties they have for young people, unless we push them as young people, they might never be able to deliver that. And so we must play our role as young people to ensure that we come out of our situations by getting engaged and being, participating meaningfully. So I think for me, that is critical.
Being engaged. John?
I just want to say that don't patronize with this old statement that youth are leaders of tomorrow, because youth are leaders of today,
right?
And we can make effective change. And I reach out to you as an Asian, Asia and Africa have an important role to play. And I think that Asia and Africa can be good partners to make this world a better place. And we thank UN Habitat, because it takes a lot of interest in these two continents. And we hope that we will continue to engage with young Kenyans. And UN Habitat welcomes your opinions. And you can write on Facebook and Twitter and other things, because social media is something that UN Habitat is encouraging a lot of young people to communicate with.
Okay, all right. Thank you both so much for coming and for giving hope, I think, to a lot of young men and women, and for us to understand that some of the issues that we face here are cross-cutting. Like I said before, we may sit in our cocoons and say, oh, these are only issues that Kenyans are facing, but it is across the world, and there is an effort that is being made by the UN Habitat to sort of bring all of us together, have an understanding of that, and to be able to find some solutions to those challenges that we face. Good job.
Thank you very much for inviting us to speak here.
Thank you. We've been speaking with John Anugraha, and Rafael Obonyo, who are from the UN Habitat Youth Advisory Council, just talking about some of the efforts that are being made on an international level to find local solutions to the problems facing young men and women. And it's not just about problems, but it's also about perhaps enlightening us to some of our hopes and our dreams and what is indeed possible. And it is possible for us to keep our member states accountable, but also, like Rafael says, on a personal level, keep yourself accountable in terms of some of those views. All right, okay. So it's about that time of the show where we read you the feedback. I'm trying to find, the tweets are so many this morning because our question of the day to you today was, do members of parliament deserve a pay hike? Okay, I got a tweet a little earlier on, don't remember it was from whom, said not necessarily a pay hike, but they're asking for the money that they were getting before. Let me just go through some of these here. Larry Ndivo says the maximum net pay inclusive of allowances for a member of parliament must be 200,000 and for the president 500,000. James Wanda, I like what you said. If this offer is acceptable to you, append your signature. Isn't this phrase part of the Members of Parliament's contracts? All right. Rogers Maitakini, you say, I thought leadership is a calling. They are asking for too much, too early. Oka says, MPs demanding a pay rise should resign. I know a couple who can do their jobs for 80,000 shillings and without bodyguards. Thomas Gitao, you say, an employee not happy with pay is free to quit and seek another job. One cannot dictate their pay. We're quite tired of the noise. I did get a few that were positive. It'll just be a bit of a challenge finding that one. But with some people just saying they agree with a lot of what Honorable Onyancha, or rather Onyonka, was saying on the show this morning. The tweets are just too many for me to go through. We'll be here probably for the whole day. All right, let's quickly go into our quote of the day today. Is this what MPs might be thinking about? Let's see. It's from Frederick Douglass this morning. It says, if there is no struggle, there is no progress. If there is no struggle, there is no progress. Think about that. Have a fantastic day. We will see you again tomorrow. Remember how we end the week. It's all about entertainment. Brenda Mai will be here with all of that to wind down the week with all the heated and important discussions that we have had. I thank my guests this morning, Honorable Richard Onyonka, John Anugraha, and Rafael Obonyo, and Martin Mutua as well, who's our editor at The Standard. All of them for making Sunrise possible. And most importantly to you for your feedback and for watching. Have a good day. See you tomorrow. My name is Yvonne Kwara. Bye-bye.